Thank you.
Thank you. I'm standing between you and Robert Caro, so I'll be short. Bob Caro is fascinated with the exercise of power and those who exercise it. That fascination led him to write The Power Broker, his brilliant biography of Robert Moses that set a whole new standard for political biography. Today, I view that Pulitzer Prize-winning book as his warm-up for tackling Lyndon Johnson, the most intelligent, complicated, committed, inspiring, and infuriating person I've ever worked for. Bob Caro is Lyndon Johnson's most demanding and meticulous biographer. Bob is fond of saying that, and I quote, "To understand power, you not only have to show how it is used, but also its effect on those on whom it is used. You have to show the effect of power on the powerless." No wonder he has become obsessed with Lyndon Johnson. Bob Caro has worked for 40 years to give the world LBJ with the bark off, his highs and lows, how this president gave new meaning to the word Machiavellian as he gave new hope to the most vulnerable among us. Robert Caro gives no quarter to the subjects he writes about, so we should all take notice of what he wrote about the president in Master of the Senate, his third Johnson volume. In the 20th century, Caro wrote, with its 18 American presidents, Lyndon Baines Johnson was the greatest champion that black Americans and Mexican Americans, and indeed all Americans of color, had in the White House. The greatest champion they had in all the halls of government. He was the lawmaker for the poor and downtrodden and the oppressed. The president who wrote mercy and justice into the statute books by which America was governed, end quote. Bob Caro's three volumes on LBJ have already won him a second Pulitzer Prize and a second National Book Award and too many other prizes and accolades for me to mention in any introduction. Of one thing I'm certain, LBJ has given Bob Caro plenty of material to win even more prizes with his next volume, Passage of Power, about the years from 1958 to 1964, when Johnson was vice president, part of those years, which will be out in May, and with his final volume on the White House years and beyond, due out in a couple of years. Indeed, Publishers Weekly, in the issue coming out on April 1st, has already called his forthcoming volume compelling, insightful, and one that will thrill all those who care about American politics. Bob, he's back there. Bob has spent some 40 years with Lyndon Johnson, and he looks great. Bill Moyers and I spent about 3 years each with him in the White House, and we're still exhausted every time we think about it. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Bob Caro.
Thank you. Joe, that was such a nice introduction that I'm reminded of what Lyndon Johnson used to say when he used to get an especially nice introduction. He used to say he wished his parents were alive to hear it, because his father would have loved it and his mother would have believed it. You know what Winston Churchill said when he was asked where he was in his great biography of Lord Marlborough? He said, "I'm working on the fifth of a projected four volumes." Well, not to equate myself with Winston Churchill, but I'm in the same boat. And in a way, this talk tonight is an explanation of how I got there. The role of government, the responsibilities of government, that's the theme of this symposium, with the focus on Lyndon Baines Johnson, 36th President of the United States, on Lyndon Johnson's concept of what the role of government should be. And that theme will be explored in detail in the panels tonight and tomorrow. But to begin this conference, I am going to talk about the origins of this concept, about its beginnings, about where Lyndon Johnson's belief in the role of government came from. about the most fundamental, basic beginnings for Lyndon Johnson. Not the beginnings in Washington, but the beginnings long before Washington. And I'll try to talk also about the origins not only of Lyndon Johnson's general beliefs about the role and responsibility of government, but also about the origins of the program in which, in a way, he announced his beliefs to the American people, about the program in which, just 7 weeks after President Kennedy's assassination, in his first State of the Union address, Johnson enunciated quite clearly his concept of what the role of government should be. It's the program with which he began his great society, the War on Poverty. For Lyndon Johnson, the beginnings are all in the place he came from, the place in which he was born and raised, the Texas Hill Country. I've talked about the Hill Country before, but I don't think you can talk about it too much, particularly in New York City. I saw what that meant growing up there myself, and it was quite a shock. I grew up in New York City, which is this place of fast-paced conversations and busy streets, theaters, and everything else. There was then a 9 o'clock plane from LaGuardia to Austin. I take that plane, and sometimes when I got off that plane, I felt you'd rent a car, you drive west out of Austin into the Hill Country, and on those days I felt like I was going from one ends of the earth to the other. I'll never forget the first time I drove out there, about 40 miles out of Austin, as you're heading towards Johnson City. There's a rise, they call it a round mountain, but it's really just a tall hill. But as I came to the top of it, something made me pull my car over to the side of the road and get out on the shoulder and look down in front of me, because I was looking at something that I had never seen before in my life. It was just emptiness. I was looking at a valley. I later found out it was 42 miles long and about 15 miles across. And when I stood there first and looked at it, I felt that there wasn't a single human thing in it to be seen. Just a tremendous expanse of emptiness. And then something happened, a cloud moved in front of the sun or away from the sun or something. And all of a sudden, there was a light glinting off a little huddle of houses in the middle of that empty space. That was Johnson City, Texas. When Lyndon Johnson was growing up there, the population was 367 at one point. When I came along, it was 362. And I think I had stopped the car then and got out of it because I realized I was confronting something that I'd never seen before and that I really wasn't equipped to deal with. As I started to interview Lyndon Johnson, you know, Lyndon Johnson died so young, at the age of 64, and I came along so quickly after he had died, that all the people who knew him, who grew up with him in Johnson City, they were just about all still there. If his best friend in high school was Truman Fawcett had moved to a bigger house, but it was still in Johnson City, just a couple of blocks away. If his first girlfriend was Kitty Clyde Ross, she was Kitty Clyde Leonard now, but she actually still lived in her parents' house. And I started to learn about this land. You know, the land, now of course Austin has pushed out into it. But then the Hill Country began just at the western edge of Austin and rolled west. It encompasses 23,000 square miles, which is an area big enough to put all of New England into it and still have room for Pennsylvania. And the population at that time was about 3 people per square mile. The first settlers called it the land of endless horizons, because every time you got to the top of one line of hills, you found that there was another one beyond it. It was a land of incredible loneliness as I started to talk to people there. I'll never forget Lyndon Johnson. Now, the Johnsons, for a large part of Lyndon's boyhood, didn't even live in Johnson City. They lived 18 miles beyond it on the Johnson Ranch. And Lyndon's brother, Sam Houston Johnson, once told me they were so lonely out there that one corner of the ranch came down to what they called the Austin-Fredericksburg Highway, which was really an unpaved just path between Austin and Fredericksburg. And he told me how Lyndon and he would go down and sit on this corner of the fence hour after hour, hoping for one new face to come along so they'd have someone new to talk to. It was a land of almost incredible poverty. There was almost no cash there. You could get a dime from selling a dozen eggs, but you had to go to Marble Falls to sell it. Marble Falls was 22 miles away across the hills. And a friend of Lyndon Johnson's, Ben Kreider, told me how he used to, on Saturdays, ride those 22 miles carrying a dozen eggs in a basket in front of me, carrying them like this so that they wouldn't break. 22 miles like that to get a dime. And I came to realize that being from New York, I simply wasn't understanding. I came back and I told Einar one night, you know, I'm not understanding these people, and I'm not understanding this country, therefore I'm not understanding Lyndon Johnson. Would you mind if we moved here? Einar, of course, said, okay, and for 3 years we rented a house up in the hill country, and I would spend day after day driving around interviewing these people. Every interview seemed to be 180 miles from the one before. Interviewing these people who grew up with Lyndon Johnson, went to college with Lyndon Johnson, or were members of his first political machine. When you move to a world, it opens up to you in ways that you can't even imagine. I mean, one thing I had heard, you know, we all heard, if you read about Lyndon Johnson, you cite a wonderful journalist for Time magazine, has a poignant scene in his book on Johnson's presidency. We're following a cabinet meeting. Johnson says, following cabinet meetings, Johnson would often say, you know, I had two Rhodes scholars at the table, all these guys from Harvard, and one graduate of Southwest Texas State Teachers College. And side, he said, Johnson would always laugh loudly at that, too loudly. And I didn't really understand what Lyndon Johnson's education, the effect that it had on him, until I went down to the college, found the textbooks that they used. And I said, gee, they're like textbooks that you would use in high school in New York. That was his college education. I found a friend of his, a guy named Joe Berry, who later became a professor at Bryn Mawr. He said, you know, when I got to Bryn Mawr, I realized I couldn't talk to anybody about anything. I felt I had been cheated out of an education. So that's part of Lyndon Johnson's upbringing. But it also showed me, living there, just how remarkable were his unique abilities to use the powers of government to improve the lives of people. While I was interviewing in the Hill Country, I came to realize that I was hearing the same thing over and over. They would tell me these stories about Johnson's ruthlessness and his cruelty, often just cruelty for the sake of being cruel. But then I would hear over and over, they would say, no matter what Lyndon was like, we loved him because he brought the lights. Well, brought the lights. Well, I knew what brought the lights meant. I mean, when Johnson became congressman in 1937 at the age of 28, there was no electricity in the Hill Country. And during his term as congressman, he brought electricity to the Hill Country. But because I came from New York City, where electricity is always just there, you turn a light switch and it's on, I understood intellectually what bringing electricity meant, but I didn't really understand what it meant or what the lives of the people of the Hill Country were like without it. Because they didn't have any electricity, of course, they didn't have movies, they didn't have radio programs. One of the poignant things that they told me was so many of these farmers and ranchers would say, you know, we loved FDR, he saved my ranch, he saved my farm. We heard all about these wonderful fireside chats, but we couldn't hear the fireside chats. The only radios they had in the Hill Country were these crystal sets, and they would describe sitting there while Roosevelt was talking, moving the needle back and forth on the dial, and trying to make his voice come in clearly. But movies and radio are just entertainment. Not having electricity means something a lot deeper than that. You can say it all, you don't have washing machines, etc., but you can say it most basically, perhaps, in water. You know, for us, we just turn a faucet, and because of electric pumps, water comes out. But in the Hill Country, water came from streams and wells. Now, the streams in the Hill Country are generally small and dried up for a large part of the year. So they had to get water out of the wells. And the water table in the hill country in general is about 75 feet deep. So they had to dig wells 75 feet and bring up water from it. The Department of Agriculture tells us that at that time, the average farm family used 200 gallons of water each day, or 73,000 gallons, or 300 tons per year. And that water had to be brought up from the wells by the women, by the wives of the house, because the husband was out in the fields working all day. And there was so little cash in the hill country that as soon as the children got old enough to work, boys and girls both, they had to work what they called off the farm on more prosperous farms in other areas of Texas, nearby areas of Texas, for a dollar a day to earn some cash money. So the woman of the house would be left there alone. I had a hard time getting these women to talk to me at the beginning because, incredibly enough, they were very shy about talking to someone from the city. So Ina, as a matter of fact, learned to make fig preserves, and she would go and become friends with the women, and then I could go back and they would talk to me more freely. And they would say to me, "You're a city boy." She says, "You don't know what bringing the water meant." They would say, and they would go to their attic or their garage, and they'd bring out a bucket of water, often with the rope still attached, frayed old rope attached. And they would take me over to the wells, which were always covered by these boards, and you'd push the boards aside, and they'd drop the bucket in, and they'd say, "You're a city boy, you don't know how heavy a bucket of water is. Now pull it up." And of course, a bucket of water, you find out, is heavy to be pulled up. In fact, it was so too heavy for these women often. So what they would do is they had this metal thing over the well, and they put the rope over it, and they do what they call walking away. They'd haul up on the rope like this to pull the bucket of water out of the well. And that's the way they had to bring up all this water that they needed for household duties. Then they would say to me, "You know, it's easier to get it to the house if you do it two buckets at a time. Do you know how we did that?" And I'll never forget the first time a woman went over to the garage and opened it and showed me her yoke, because that's how these women carried the water, with yokes over their shoulders like cattle. You know, I realized that I was hearing another thing. I had been hearing another thing in a lot of these interviews with the women. They would say things like, "Do you see how round-shouldered I am? Do you see how stooped I am? Bent." They would say, "Do you see how bent I am?" The word in the hill country is really bent. "Do you see how bent I am?" And in fact, I had sort of noticed that these women seemed a great deal more stooped than city women. But I thought it was just because they were old. But they would say, "I got bent like this before my time. My back got bent like this when I was young." These women were stooped at 40, stooped at 35. So one woman said to me, "I swore that I wasn't going to look like my mother looked. But then the babies started to come, and I had to bring the water, and I knew I was going to look exactly like my mother looked." They would show me what wash days were like because they didn't have electricity. They would take out four number three zinc wash tubs, and you'd line them up on your lawn, and you'd build a fire under each one, and you transfer. The first one was the lye soap, and they didn't have enough money to buy store-bought soap, so they had to make their own soap out of lye. And there was another expression in the hill country: lye soap peels the skin off your hand like gloves. But you'd put the first load of wash in, and scrub it out with the lye soap, and then they say, "You're a city boy, you don't know how heavy a load of wet wash is on the end of a broomstick, do you?" And they would give me, and it's very heavy. There'd be the lye wash tub, the rinsing wash tub, the bluing or starch wash tub, and then the other rinsing wash tub. So they had to transfer these between the wash tubs, and they, on an average day, as near as I could tell, there were 8 to 10 loads of wash in the hill country family. And this, I'll never forget how my back hurt on wash days. Tuesday was ironing. I'm not going to bore you all by going through a day of the week. I named that, they called it, I named the chapter after what they called Tuesday, the sad irons, because they, because you didn't have electricity, an iron was a hunk of metal with a wooden handle, which you would transfer from iron to iron. And you'd have to get them hot on the stove. And that meant you had to stand next to the stove all day doing your ironing. And it's nothing in the hill country for it to get up to 105 or 106 degrees, sort of day by day there. So these people were living lives out of the Middle Ages. They were living like peasants. Lyndon Johnson runs for Congress at the age of 28. And he says, if you elect me, I will bring electricity. Well, they elected him. And Lyndon Johnson was a political genius. And he gears his campaign to the women. And what he said, the line that he uses is, if you elect me, you won't look like your mother does. They elect him, but no one really believes that he can bring electricity. I mean, there is no dam, no source of dam in the hill country. A dam has been started at the edge of the hill country, but it's the Depression, it's 1937. The company that was doing it has run out of money to do it, and so the dam is stopped. And even if you build a dam, how are you going to get electricity out to these scattered farms, isolated farms, miles one by one, laying lines across the hill? Well, to watch Lyndon Johnson do that, to watch him do what he had to do to get the dam built, then persuade the Rural Electrification Administration to violate all their rules and lay these lines when I think they had a minimum of like 10 people per mile, or they wouldn't lay lines, but they didn't have that there, but he gets them to do it. He keeps asking Roosevelt for money to build the dam. Every time he sees him, he asks him for money. He has intermediaries, Roosevelt's aides. They're always asking him. Finally, Roosevelt said, oh, give the kid the dam. And electricity comes to the hill country. And these people, the people of his 10th congressional district, are brought in a stroke by one man using governmental, his genius for government, brings them into the 20th century. And the fact that he did that means that we see in the hill country the beginnings of what I'm talking about, the beginnings of something else in Lyndon Johnson, not just an understanding of what should be done to help people who were fighting forces too big for them to fight themselves. They were never going to get electricity on their own. No private company was going to bring it in there. It wasn't profitable enough. Not just an understanding of what should be done to help people, but the ability to help them. A gift that he had, quite a rare gift, really, a talent that was beyond talent, to use the powers of government to help people trying to fight forces too big for them to fight themselves. You know, his father was a populist legislator, served 6 terms in the Texas House of Representatives, and he used to say that the proper function of government was to help people caught in the tentacles of circumstance. The tentacles of circumstance, fighting things too big for you to help to fight yourself. Joe said that I try to write about the effect of power on the powerless and how power is used on the powerless. Also, you try to write about how power is used for the powerless. Now we go forward to 1963. President Kennedy was assassinated, of course, on November 22nd, and Lyndon Johnson has become president. Under President Kennedy, there had been some vague, hardly defined early discussions about a poverty program, an anti-poverty program, because over one-fifth of the United States, 33 million people actually, in that year, 1963, were still living below the poverty line. On the day after the assassination, on the Saturday, November 23rd. At the end of the day, Lyndon Johnson meets in his office in the executive office building, he still hasn't moved into the White House, with 4 of President Kennedy's economic advisors, Walter Heller, who's chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, Kermit Gordon, the director of the Budget Bureau, Douglas Dillon, the Secretary of the Treasury, and Gardner Ackley, whose title escapes me at the moment. He was a deputy to Heller. The meeting is about the budget. Johnson is coming in the middle of the budget process, knowing very little about it, has to get brought up to speed. It's a long meeting, but at the end of the meeting, As Heller is leaving, he's walking out the open door, and Lyndon Johnson is beside him. We know what Heller said, and we know what Johnson's response was, because both Heller and Ackley left notes on the meeting, and their notes coincide exactly. Heller mentions the anti-poverty program. Johnson shuts the door. He says, "That's my kind of program. I'll find money for it one way or the other." Heller had, up to that point, Johnson had said a lot of things about budget and his various priorities, and Heller had formed an impression, and I'll read from his notes. His other remarks, Johnson's other remarks, he said, was, quote, "a little calculated, a play for support. There he was, Lyndon Johnson, the politician," close quote. Not about this, however. Standing at that door, Heller suddenly feels that there was no calculation at all in Lyndon Johnson's response to poverty. That was so spontaneous, so immediate, an instinctive and intuitive and uncalculated response. All his life, people who worked for Johnson for years knew about those moments of instinctive, uncalculated responses, always in response to injustice, social injustice, or social need. Those of you who have read my books know there was a moment like that in 1949 when he learns that a Mexican-American soldier has been killed in the Philippines during World War II, has been denied burial in his South Texas cemetery, the cemetery of the South Texas town, because he's not white. On the instant, John Connolly and Walter Jenkins are standing there when Johnson, they hand him the telegram. Johnson reads it, and without a moment's hesitation, he says, "By God, we'll bury him in Arlington." All through his life, there are these moments, and here is another one. That Christmas, that December, Johnson goes down for a two-week vacation on his ranch. And Heller finds out that his analysis, his feeling that this was spontaneous, uncalculated, he finds out that that analysis was correct. Johnson is down on the ranch, the Johnson Ranch, the ranch that his father lost and that he has now bought back. And when Heller and Kermit Gordon get there, they find that those words weren't meaningless. Johnson has found new money, $500 million, for an anti-poverty program. And they find he is determined to push it through Congress. He gives them a lesson in political tactics. They had thought of a program as a targeted demonstration program with demonstration programs in a limited number of cities. Johnson says, tries to make them understand that a limited number of districts means that a limited number of congressmen are going to get benefits from that program. And he says in his memoirs, "I was certain that we could not start small and propel a program through Congress." He tells them they have to, his quote is something like, "I knew we had to do it big or we wouldn't get it through Congress at all." And they see he's very determined. He keeps asking them, "How are you going to spend all this money? I've earmarked $500 million to get this program started, but I'll withdraw it unless you fellows come through with something that's workable." Very determined. And when you ask where this determination came from, as always with Lyndon Johnson, part of the explanation is political. He was weak with, he had an election coming up in 10 months. He was weak with liberals, weak in the big cities of the Northeast, in the liberal urban areas. A campaign against poverty would strengthen Johnson in these areas. So part of it is political, as always with Johnson. But as always with Lyndon Johnson, part of the explanation is something more. Something that had to do with the fact that when he was doing this, when he was thinking of this anti-poverty program, he was doing it back in the Hill Country where his father had gone broke, and he had grown up in poverty, back in the ranch, back at his beginnings. How do we know that those beginnings were very much in his mind as he's dealing with the anti-poverty program that Christmas? Well, he talks very often during those weeks about his boyhood and about a particular thing in his boyhood, having to get up early. Most of the books on Johnson quote a very cute remark that he made to reporters as he's flying down to the ranch. He says, "I've always been an early riser. My daddy used to come to my bedroom at 4:30 in the morning when I was working on the highway gang right out of high school, and he'd twist my big toe real hard so he hurt, and he'd say, 'Get up, Lyndon. Every other boy in town's got a half hour's head start on you.'" That's sort of cute. But there's nothing really cute about other things he said about being poor. Called an old, I was interviewing an old hill country ally of his, a guy named E. Babe Smith, who went back a long way with Lyndon Johnson. He recalls him saying, he calls him early one morning and he says, he hopes he hasn't woken him up. Then he says, "I'm sure I haven't, because you were a poor boy too. And therefore you must have been getting up all your life, just like me." This is the quote. "That's the only way we can keep up," he said. "Otherwise they're too far ahead of us." Calls an attorney in Fredericksburg who's known since his boyhood, man named Arthur Staling, and says, "We always get up early, don't we?" When Staling answers the phone on the first ring, "We can't make it unless we do." At the age of 9 and 10, Lyndon Johnson had worked in the cotton fields beside his cousin, Ava, hauling cotton on their knees all day under the broiling hill country sun. I asked, that Christmas, we know from the diary, the backup diary that the aides kept, that the presidential aides keep, that Johnson and Lady Bird visit Ava in Johnson City to bring her a poinsettia for Christmas, and I asked Ava if she remembered what they had talked about, and she said she didn't, except that she was sure that they had talked about the cotton picking. She said whenever she and Lyndon got together, the subject of cotton came up. "We always talked about the cotton," she said. "We just hated that so much." Hate is a word that occurs very frequently when people talk about Lyndon Johnson's feelings about poverty. In a memoir that was written by his longtime cardiologist, Dr. Willis Hurst, Dr. Hurst writes that he hated poverty and illiteracy. He hated it, it's in italics. He hated it when a person who wanted to work could not get a job. And then he recounts an incident that occurred when he was accompanying Johnson during his vice presidency on a trip to Iran. And they pass a group of Iranian children, and somebody remarks that they have rags for clothing. And Johnson flies into a rage and says, as Hearst recalls it, "Don't say that. I know rags when I see them. They had patched clothes. That's a lot different from rags." And I suddenly remembered, when I read this reminiscence of Dr. Hurst, something that Lyndon's brother, Sam Houston Johnson, had told me about them growing up. And I couldn't quite recall, which is why I didn't quote it exactly in the book, but only in general. I hadn't thought to take a note of it at the time, but I remember Sam Houston saying something like, when he was describing their poverty, that he and his sister Rebecca had to wear patched clothes. And I remember he said something to me like, "But they weren't rags." So these are the beginnings of Lyndon Johnson on the anti-poverty program, the War on Poverty. And you know how much the War on Poverty meant to Lyndon Johnson. If you just listen to the words with which he introduced the War on Poverty in that first State of the Union speech when he flew back to Washington from the ranch to deliver it on January 8, 1964. The writing of the speech is interesting in that regard. Johnson had persuaded Ted Sorensen, the great speechwriter for John F. Kennedy, to stay on at least for a while and help him with his speeches, a short while. And he had flown Sorensen and his three little boys down to Texas, and they were staying at the Lewis Ranch, which is some miles away from the Johnson Ranch. His little boys, Sorensen's little boys, his dad was supposed to spend time with us that Christmas, but all we remember is him scribbling in this little room at the end of the hall. Several evenings he went down to the ranch house talking to Johnson about the speech. But when you analyze those drafts, and you can see them in the Johnson Library draft by draft, Sorensen draft one, Sorensen draft two, you see how much of it came from Johnson. Some of it, when he delivers the speech, are real Lyndon Johnson words. Sorensen had written, "This administration declares unconditional war on poverty in America." The speech is delivered by Lyndon Johnson is, "This administration today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty in America." He had added four words, "today, here and now," Lyndon Johnson words. And the speech said, "Unfortunately, many Americans live on the outskirts of hope, some because of their poverty and some because of their color, and all too many because of both. Our task is to help that one-fifth of all American families with incomes too small to even meet their basic needs. Our chief weapons will be better schools and better health and better homes and better training and better job opportunities to help more Americans, especially young Americans, escape from squalor and misery and unemployment rolls." You know, it's interesting to watch that speech on tape today. As Lyndon Johnson says those three words, squalor, misery, unemployment, his eyes behind the thick glasses he had to wear for speeches narrow. And I wrote, his lips, set already in that grim, tough line, tightened and twisted into an expression close to a snarl. And he continued with words that, while none of them applied specifically to the circumstances of his own life, might nevertheless have had a special resonance for someone who had grown up in poverty and who knew it was only because he hadn't been given a fair chance. And of course, Lyndon Johnson passed the war on poverty, passed so many of the other bills that will be discussed during the rest of this symposium. He showed in his presidency, he demonstrated in his presidency what he had demonstrated as a young congressman, a rare gift, a talent beyond talent, a talent that was genius for transmuting compassion into government action, to transmute compassion into government action that would make the compassion meaningful. The life of Lyndon Johnson is a very complicated life, but two aspects of it shine through all the complications, shine brightly through all the dark episodes. One is the compassion, the sympathy for, the empathy for people, poor people, people of color, people caught in the tentacles of circumstance. And the other is the great gift, the talent beyond talent, to make compassion meaningful. Meaningful how? To help people fight forces too big for them to fight alone. The proper role of government. And as I said at the beginning of my talk, it all went back to the beginning. Now, I may have talked too long, but if I could write short, I wouldn't always be writing 1,000-page books. Thank you.